When Labor came to power in 2017, improving New Zealand's mental health services was a major focus. But 6 years on, a top forensic psychiatrist is questioning what progress has actually been made and urging the new government to reassess priorities in mental health. Dr. Erik Monasterio worked in the public health service for 25 years. He gave evidence in the recent Lauren Dickerson trial, but he says he grew so exasperated with the state of the public health service and support for acute mental disorders that he left.
Look, it's a sad story for me because I'm a product of the public service. I finished my medical training in New Zealand. I did my specialty training and subspecialty training in forensic psychiatry. And then I worked in the forensic service for 25 years, eventually moving into a position of leadership. But the last 5 to 7 years, I've just seen this decay in the mental health services in New Zealand. And I did everything in my power to try to change that. And from within the system, I couldn't achieve that change. And therefore, as a leader, I felt that if I couldn't achieve the change while I was leading, and in a leadership position, I was seeing intolerable situations, the only option available to me was to resign and eventually try to work from outside of the system, if you like.
When you say decay, what do you mean?
Look, what I mean is that as we're sitting here in the studio, there are hundreds of people with serious mental illness living on the streets and increasingly in prison. And we're talking about a degree of psychiatric pathology at the extreme end. Now, in New Zealand, we have the Mental Health Act, which, whilst it's criticised, it's also the piece of legislation that ensures that people with serious mental disorders are identified and treated appropriately. And as I said, there are dozens of people who will qualify for the Mental Health Act and who are languishing in prison or on the streets. And let's compare this to other services within the health system. If you have an acute severe mental disorder and qualify for the Mental Health Act, it's the equivalent in a surgical service to somebody who needs an operation here and now. Let's say it's the equivalent of an acute appendicitis. Now, no matter how stretched the health service is, if you turn up to ED and you have an acute appendicitis, you will get your operation. If you have a myocardial infarct or a heart attack, you will get treatment for that. The equivalent for mental health services is if you meet criteria for the act and you have something which is comparable to those surgical and medical needs, you're not getting the care. And often these days, you're either living on the streets or you're remanded to custody. And those approaches almost guarantee a worse outcome for those disorders and an extraordinary level of human suffering.
What is it about the last 7 years that has led to the decay?
In general, we talk about a crisis in health. Psychiatry's never been particularly good at securing and ring-fencing its resources. So relative to medical specialties, we're underfunded. But increasingly, we've just failed to keep pace with population growth, with the complexity of issues in the community, and services are beleaguered. People are leaving because it's a tough environment to work in. And me in the public service, after 25 years, I'm leaving myself. I never wanted to leave, but I found that I just couldn't stay in that situation and prop up a system where it was, you know, causing so much harm.
This will just come as a surprise to many of our viewers who will recall, of course, that over the last 6 years, over the previous government, there was a lot of focus and resource put into mental health generally. So there was funding, but there was also the inquiry into mental health and addiction. What has been the result of that attention and focus?
Look, the Mental Health and Addictions Inquiry set itself a broad scope. And as its starting point, it set itself the challenge to look beyond serious mental illness to mental distress. And the broadness of its focus means that at the more severe end of the spectrum, those with severe mental illness have actually been, not entirely, but to some extent, sidelined and ignored. So it's one of the unintended consequences of the Mental Health Inquiry is that the expectation now has been set so high that those with severe mental illness are actually missing out.
So is that a case of spreading resources over a broader group of people rather than maybe defining those resources for people at the more acute end of the scale?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think there's an ideological basis of it. Mm. And you've got to be careful that ideological directions don't have unintended consequences. Mm. And I think there is unintended consequences here. But as a starting point, before the Mental Health and Addictions Inquiry, we were already signalling to the government and to the ministry that there were insufficient resources to manage those at the severe end of the spectrum. Mm. And if you look at the Mental Health and Addictions Inquiry, it proposes at the outset that the 3% of seriously mentally disordered in New Zealand were already well catered to. But that wasn't the case. The ministry was aware of that, and the government was aware of that, because we provided them with plenty of information to highlight to them the unmet need for those at the more severe end of the spectrum, particularly those in prisons who could not get into hospital.
That's right. So to what extent are we incarcerating those experiencing severe mental distress or disorder?
Yeah, look, and this is perhaps one of the most concerning aspects of what my job has been, because I am a forensic psychiatrist. I work in prisons. And what we're seeing in New Zealand is that prisons are now becoming the new psychiatric institutions. So we are incarcerating the mentally disordered. And often they're in prison over trivial charges simply because there are no beds available in the public health system. So it's become a new norm to place somebody into prison rather than to take them into hospital. It's a bit like going back to my metaphor of the person with an acute appendicitis. Mm. Somebody with that level of need is going to prison. Mm. And the environment in prison will almost guarantee a worse outcome for them.
Yeah, talk to us about that. I realise that there is perhaps no one outcome, but what would be the typical consequences for someone experiencing severe mental disorder who's incarcerated?
So generally, a severe mental disorder, the most common diagnosis, if you like, it's a psychotic disorder. Mm. So those are the people that are having delusional beliefs. They're out of touch with reality. They're often persecuted. They think government agencies or the devil is talking about them, persecuting against them. Mm. They often hear voices. They're distracted by what we call perceptual disturbances. So as they're out of touch with reality, they often are disruptive in their behaviours. Mm. They don't engage well. They're often become disenfranchised from their families. They either end up living on the streets or behaving oddly. They come before the court. Very often, would sufficient resources be available, they would go into hospital. Mm. But if a bed's not available, they may go into prison. And prison is a tough environment, right? So if you go into prison and you behave oddly, you're at risk to yourself and potentially to others. So it's not rare for somebody with a psychotic disorder that then end up in a part of the prison called the Intervention and Support Unit, where they're subject to isolation for 23 or 24 hours a day, and they're held in cells which you couldn't design a worse health, a cell for somebody with a serious mental disorder. They're isolated from others. They often don't have a window to the outside world. If their behaviour's disturbed enough, they won't even have a toilet. Mm. They're locked down 23 hours a day. So you imagine a person in an ISU cell, hearing voices, having paranoid beliefs, believing that somebody's going to come in and harm them, and you leave them there 23 hours a day. The staff in prison have not been trained to manage that group of people. Mm. Now, that isolation, we know unequivocally, leads to worse outcomes for people with serious mental illness. And they may be there for weeks waiting to come into hospital, and at times they never get into hospital at all.
When you left the DHB, what was done to understand why you left?
Very little. I didn't have an exit interview. I did signal my concerns to the DHB. And I'm not here to discuss my dissatisfaction about why I left the public health service. I'm here to implore people to look for a solution. And the solutions will come when we understand why we're in this mess. And part of that is to talk to people who are leaving the service to understand why it is that we're leaving. If you don't understand the basis of the problem, you'll never solve that problem. And it would be helpful for Te Whatu Ora to tell us how many specialists are leaving the public health service. because when they leave, they take decades of experience with them, which is not easily replaced. Mental health is particularly unique because it's got a social-cultural context that we need to understand. And psychiatrists are trained to understand the social-cultural context of New Zealand. So their expertise is not easily replaced by psychiatrists coming from overseas. We need to understand why they're leaving, and we need to do something about
it. And is your experience that other psychiatrists are leaving the public health system?
Oh, I know they are. I know they are, and they're doing it in increasingly large numbers.
And why do they tell you that is? Why do your colleagues say they're leaving?
Look, I don't want to put words into my colleagues' mouth, but we reflect on the situation and there is a consensus of agreement. And the difficulty is there's a lack of good, effective leadership that would make us feel confident that there is a way through this difficult situation. Hey, look, people will tough out the hard times if you have a plan to eventually get to a better outcome. I don't think we have that level of leadership. Division isn't there. So people get burnt out, they get frustrated, and they move on. And in mental health in particular, I think this is very telling, because psychiatry is not the most glorified of medical specialties. It's certainly not the highest paying. It takes anywhere between 12 and 14 years to reach the status of a junior consultant psychiatrist. And in my experience, the people that go into that profession have a high level of conscience and a high level of engagement to help those who are most disadvantaged in our community. So if those people are leaving, who are very altruistic by nature, there is something going amiss here.
What would be your message to the incoming government as to where their focus should be when it comes to mental health?
We need to listen to our staff. We need to establish the level of unmet need. We need to look at how many people who have had contact with specialist mental health services are ending up in prison. So if you've got a history of contact with specialist mental health services, how many of those people are ending up in prison, and why are they there? And that will give you an estimation of the unmet need at the most severe end of the spectrum. And you need adequate leadership to identify where the problems sit, stratify the importance of addressing each issue, and then have a plan moving forward.
You talked at the start of the interview about focus shifting over the last few years from the acute end, mental disorders, into people experiencing mental distress as well. Is it possible under our current system to resource both of those, to make sure that actually things at the acute end of the scale are well resourced, but also people experiencing mental distress get the help they need?
Look, and that is a good question and a challenging question, because before the Mental Health and Addictions Inquiry, we already knew we were woefully short of staff. In 2013, Professor Des Gorman advised the government that there would be a nursing crisis in New Zealand because we were not training sufficient people in nursing. The median age of nurse were in their 50s, so in the next decade, they were going to reach retirement age. And even though there was a prediction of this crisis, very little was done. And now here we are, where we are woefully short of nurses, and here we have a mental health and addictions inquiry, which has expanded the focus, promised a lot to the community, but we were always short staffed to even meet the most severe end of needs. How can we manage such a broad range of need? So it is really challenging. The question now is, do we refocus? How as a society do we determine where our limited resources should go? Is it acceptable to place somebody in custody who's got a serious mental illness and they're extremely distressed, and then be held in situations where they're subject essentially to sensory deprivation for 23 hours a day? Is that not something that needs to be urgently addressed? It breaches many legal standards and agreements that New Zealand's a signatory to. I think it's illegal to do it, by the way, but it is happening every day.